So this one is the fourth lecture, lecture number four. Again, I have given title of this one, Introduction to Probability, but basically I will discuss here conditional probability. So coming to outline of my today's lectures, these are the outline. First, I will give few example of probabilistic model that what we had already discussed about elementary probability. So based on that, I will take few example and I will also do formulation, how to formulate that. And also I will try to find probability or probability measure. Once we will cover that section, we will go to discuss about conditional probability. Here we won't go in rigorous way, just I will give intuition and few problem based on that intuition and how we can define conditional probability from one given problem, and based on that we can generalize that definition for other problem as well. So generic view first, my approach would be I will start with example, then from that example I will come with definition of conditional probability, then I will go to generalize it, and later we will see that one part is conditional probability, another part is coming partition of sample of space, and combining these two we will introduce multiplication rule for probability, and in general we will go to discuss about Bayes' theorem. And Bayes' theorem now these days very important. It is even directly it is providing a machine learning tools that we are calling it naive Bayes classifier. So apart from that, there is a separate branch of statistics that we are calling it Bayesian statistics. What is happening that here definitely regarding any kind of system, someone definitely may have prior information. Based on that prior information, you can estimate the posterior probability. So all these calculation of posterior probability, it would be very helpful in solving many machine learning problems. So those things I will talk in detail, how to calculate posterior probability based on prior belief or prior probability. So you know that belief and probability both are synonymous to each other. Sometimes also you can say that it is my initial probability or initial belief, or later you will come to know that if you are expert or somehow you have knowledge about that problem from experience, then you can have a very good prior. But if one novice person is coming, doesn't have any idea, then that time it is just luck by chance that for novice person may have a very good prior or may have a very bad prior. Very bad prior always just that will force you to diverge from the problem. But if you are having very good prior, then definitely you are going to get a very interesting kind of measurement of posterior probability. So those things we will discuss as an application of conditional probability. So and this Bayes' theorem I have already written here. I will discuss in next class, not in this class. So consider this Bayes' theorem as a precap. So coming to examples from elementary probability as a few probabilistic model, I am taking first example that is related with throwing a dice. So what we do, consider an experiment of throwing a die or dice, also you can say that dice, as the dice has six sides or six faces, you can say that the natural sample of space for this probabilistic model would be what? It would be this set, this discrete set having six element, one refer for the first phase, two refer for the phase two, and three refer for the phase three. So all these things you know, that quantification of that possible outcome, you know that. So we have already collected all the possible outcome that make a sample space for this random experiment of throwing a dice. Now to assign probability to event, we will make the modeling assumption that each of the outcome that dice is equally here. While throwing a dice, we are getting each of the outcome happens to be equally likely. So equally likely, due to that, what we will come to know that before the experiment is performed, we are equally certain that the dice will come up as a head or as a two, sorry, no, as a, it will comes up either one or two or etc, something like that. And hence modeling assumption can therefore be written in two way. So I had already told that sample of space having two property, one property we are calling it mutually exclusiveness. And due to that, we say that here all the outcome, possible outcome are equally likely. That means all are having the same probability. That is the meaning of equally likely. Another, in the quantification, if you try to quantify the equally likely concept, then you can say that like this way. So, and also all the events, these outcome happens to be mutually exclusive. So you can observe that here intersection of this event 1 and intersection of this event 2 are definitely intersection would be 5. There is no common thing between 1 and 2. So that's why all these are events happens to be, or all these outcomes happens to be mutually exclusive. Second property of sample space is coming that all these outcomes, they are collectively exhaustive. That means if you sum up the probability of all these, then sum of the probability it will give this probability of sample space. And what is the probability of sample space? It is collection of all possible outcomes. The probability of a sample space is always certain. That means it is always 1. So due to that, also we know that from equally likely condition that all these probability are equal to each other. So due to that, you will come across to see that probability of each outcome happens to be 1/6. If you simplify these two equations, you will come to know that probability of getting phase 1 is 1/6, also probability of getting phase 2 is 1/6, also probability of getting 3 is also 1/6. So equally likely, all are equally likely. So all these equally likely concepts are coming from two property of the sample space. One is mutually exclusive, another one is collectively exhaustive nature. So from there we have deducted this equally likely probability of the outcome. Now coming to in between, if you have any question you can ask, otherwise I am going to, it is that example was very basic and elementary example, you have already seen several times. So I am taking one more example, waiting for a bus. So waiting time by default time is silent here, so time would be here, waiting time for a bus. So for this problem, what we do, we are waiting for a bus at the bus stop, and based on previous experience we make the following modeling assumptions. So definitely when you apply some kind of probabilistic model, you always put some kind of assumption. So what is that? The bus always comes within at most one hour. That means bus is coming in the interval 0 to 1. So if you measure time in hour, so it is coming in the interval between 0 to 1, but it is equally likely to come at any time in between that hour, okay, within this hour. So equally likely, whether it will come at 15 or come within that means in the first 15 minute, or whether it will come between 15 to 30 minute, or 30 to 45 minute. All these events are equally likely in sense. So meaning of equally likely. So what is that? So first question would be, what is the sample space first? So sample space we have already designed it. We have taken one assumption that we are just counting within at the first at most 1 hour. So that's why our sample space would be 0 to 1. Time is taking between 0 to 1 hour. Okay. To define probability measure, consider for the example following subset of A and B of the sample space, this omega. So here we have taken, so there are two subset we have taken. This one is one subset, you can call it event A. This one is second subset, we are calling it event B. I had already mentioned that event happens to be some outcomes, and sample space it can cover all possible outcomes. That is the criteria. And in such a way, if you are taking your sample space happens to be an interval, then by default we know that from calculus 1 or calculus, what we know that if you're taking an interval, and if someone is asking please find some subsets of that interval, then subset of that interval always also happens to be subset in interval in nature. So that's why I have taken interval kind of, so this subset A, it is talking about interval x to x plus epsilon. That means A is an interval of length epsilon, B is also interval of length epsilon, but it is not within A, it is away from A. So A and B are two distinct event in the same sample space. So this is the criteria. And if you talk about other things, what are the properties of why it is happening interval, subset of a interval happens to be interval, so you can see that calculus course. And if you face any problem, if you are interested, then I may come across reasoning of that, why it is happening, such kind of things. I will explain if you need to know that. Otherwise, there is no much necessary. It is not mandatory to understand that why it is happening. So going further, because our modeling assumption is that bus is equally likely to come at any time in the interval 0 to 1, the probability that the bus arrive at a time in the set A should be equal to same that probability that bus is arriving at a time in B. Why? Because we know that length of A and length of B both are same. That's why and also we have already taken equally likely assumptions. So that's why probability that bus will arrive in the set A and bus will arrive in the set B both would be equally likely. Okay, this interval, why? Because this interval contains the same length of that time. So this is the proper reasoning why both are equally likely, because both are having the same length. So in direct we can say that the probability we can define as a length of the given particular event as a subset of the given interval 0, 1. So you can define the, if you are taking a event A as a subset of sample space omega, then you can say that probability of A is nothing, just it is length of the A. And you know that if it is interval, it is very easy to find length of the interval, because we know that if you are having an interval AB, then always in interval always happens to be a uncountable set. And for that perspective, if someone is asking that what is the length of this one, so if I am writing length L of interval AB, just what you do, subtract A from B. So this is directly giving length of the interval AB. So in this, that means it is very easy to find probability of an event for this problem. So one example, suppose A, we have taken A to A plus epsilon. So definitely probability of A would be what? It is just length of this interval. And what is the length of this interval? It is just epsilon. So that's where epsilon we have taken. So one practical example, if you are taking an interval in the sample space omega 0 to 0.25, and what would be the probability of this one? That the bus will come, what is the probability that bus will come in this interval? So probability is this one, 0.25. So bus will come with probability 0.25. That means 25% chance is there that bus will come in this interval. And if someone is asking what is the probability that bus will come exactly at a particular time x, so here what happened, if sample space is continuous in nature, so someone is asking about particular time at x, so then we know that what is the length of a single point. So length of a single point is always zero. If you are taking a point and someone is asking what is the length of a point, the length doesn't have a point, it is just a point. So you will, because for a point, terminal point, that initial point and final point both would be same. So that means if you are taking a point x, then if you are trying to find length of this one, it would be what? Length of x would be x minus x. X minus x is what? Zero. So that's where probability that thus bus will come exactly at x would be zero. Why? Because length of that point is zero. So interval is having positive length, but point is having zero length. So that is the criteria. If someone asks, so it is a very interesting kind of concept that when your sample space is continuous in nature, then simply you can't define probability point wise. You have to define probability interval wise. So this is the case where we are defining probability interval wise. So interval is very important. So I am putting here one remark for generalization perspective of continuous case. So as this is a computational mathematics course, we will sometimes sweep some purely technical issue under the rug. So what technical issue it would be? It would be related with continuous probabilistic model, where we do calculate length of the interval. So it is not always possible to calculate length of the interval. Someone tell me what is the length of this one? Anyone can say that? Because you have already gone through calculus class. So if I'm asking what is the length of minus 2 intersection Q is set of rational number. Anyone, can you talk about length of this interval? Who is having very good command and very good marks in math 1? One. No, it is not one. Even if you just blindly try to answer, then it would be not one. Simply it would be one. You try to answer like 2 minus minus of 2, so it would be 4 blindly if you don't think much about that. If you don't think much about that, so what I have taken, that here I have taken minus interval minus 2 to 2. So if you talk about from real number perspective, the length of that interval is what? It would be 4 now. It would be 4 from the real. Dilip, are you getting or not? Yeah. So from real number perspective, it would be 4. But intentionally, I have taken rational number. The intersection with rational number, so it is no more 4. It is 0. It is 0. Are you getting it? I think that concept is very tedious task. That one is very tedious task, because if someone is asking what is the length of a rational number, all the rational number collectively, then I would give only one answer. It is 0. Why? Because there is a very interesting result from math 1 that we are calling it countable set. Have you heard that countable set? It is very important, because you people will study algorithm. You have to apply algorithm. So if you are willing to apply algorithm, so what is happening? Everything happens mostly in sequential pattern. So what is the general perspective of sequence? What is the meaning of sequence? How you can visualize sequential pattern? Where you can visualize? Do you visualize sequential pattern in rational number? Prashant, do you know what is rational number is countable or uncountable? Have you heard the word of countable and uncountable set? Because we will study two important random variable. One would be discrete random variable, another would be continuous random variable. I was not willing to cover that countability right now. I was willing to cover that during a random variable. So have you heard the word of countable and uncountable set? Anyone? All these are very interesting factor that directly coming from math 1. Have you heard or not? Because you have already gone through sequence and series kind of things. Abhishek, do you know anything about countable and uncountable set? Don't consider that it is a very much abstract concept. It is having very practical application. Abhishek, are you listening to me or not? No. Okay, Sarang, would you like to answer that? If you are really willing to understand mathematics, you should know all these basic concepts, that what is countable set, what is uncountable set. Not, I am not asking definition. I never worry about definition. I'm just asking whether are you understanding countable set or uncountable set? No, not, or whether you are understanding or not. Discrete. Yeah, it is not a correct way you tried, but what is happening? Discrete is just part of countable set. Countability. Discrete is just one part of countability. So you should no set of natural number is countable set. That's why I told that it is what is your right pronunciation? Talwar. Ananya. Okay. So actually, if you are willing to define a set of natural number, it is countable. Even you can go up to set of rational number. rational number are also countable. So what is the basic definition? It is directly coming from sequence. So what you do? You take a set and try to put every element of that set in sequential pattern. So if you are able to put every point, every element of that set, whether it is finite or infinite, in a proper sequence, then simply you can say that that set is a countable set. If you fail to put every element of that set, remember that I am saying that every element, if you fail to put every element of that set in a particular sequential pattern, then simply you can say that that set is no more countable set, that set is uncountable set. Did you get it or not? Like if I am taking set of natural number, then easily we can define a sequence. What would be sequence? An equal to n, an equal to 1, n. So you are getting a sequence. And simply again, if you go integer, what you do? Map all odd number to what? There are two kind of things, odd and even number. So you do one thing, divide all the even number by 2, and regarding odd number, what you do? Divide all the even number by 2 and map to positive integer, and subtract all the even odd even number, you can divide it by 2. So divide all the even number by 2 and map to positive integer, and subtract all the odd number by minus 1 and divide by 2 and map to negative integer. Then you will get a bijection, you will get a sequence. So I'm directly coming to PPT. There you will see one picture of all this. So these are important to apply concept of programming there when you are trying to solve the problem in a empirical way or sequential pattern. So I would like to take a blank slide here. It is fine. So I told that set of natural number. So set of natural number, we always denote it by like this way. So set of natural number is having this kind of entries: 1, 2. It is proper well ordering set. There is a order property, and it will go up to infinity. You know the last first element of natural number, set of natural number, we don't know last element, so it is infinite set. So we can define here a sequence an equal to n. That means every element you can put in this form, in the sequential form, you can put it like this way, that is natural number, where an is equal to n. So that's way we can say that set of natural number is a countable number. If you go to integer, integer is what? Integer, it start from minus infinity. That means both side it is non-terminating. So minus negative integer first will come. So minus 3, minus 2, minus 1. Then there is a central integer that we are calling it 0. Then 1 will come. Then 2 will come. So what you do? Try to map, define a bijective map between z to n. If you are able to define a bijective map, that means 1, 1 and on to map, then you can claim that z is a, that means set of integer is a, what? It is a countable set. If you fail to define a bijective map, you can't say that. So how you can define bijective map? So you can define it by very, very simple way. So n, you will define like this way. When we never talk about positive integer, we never talk about odd integer or even integer. We are talking about positive, the odd number, even number. So generally deal in natural number. So what we do, suppose n is a odd number, or so first take add n is an even number. So if it is even, then easily we can define it by divided by 2. That means we are putting a condition here, n is even number, that means n is here equal to 2 times some integer. two times n. It is meaning of that even. And n is odd, then we will what we will do? We subtract that n by 1 and divide by 2, and we will take a negative number, negative of that when n is odd. So due to this definition, this one you can verify that this one is a bijective map from n to z or z to n. Bijective map is always invertible. You know that. So from here you can see picture like this way. If I am taking 2, 2 has been mapped to where? 2 divided by 2, it would be 1. If you are taking 3, where 3 is mapped? What is the image of 3 under this sequence? Who would like to answer? Or what is the image of 1? Anyone? Would you like to give answer under this? I have already given the map, this map. Take n equal to 1 and put substitute in this definition. Just do little bit practice. It is not a very tedious task. Yeah, 0. Nice. So that I want to listen. So if you put n equal to 1 here, then here we can't put, because n 1, we can't divide it by 2. 1 is a odd number, so that's why we will take it here. So if you 1 minus 1 is 0, 0 divided by 2 is 0. So 1 will map to 0. Now come to 3. Where 3 will map? Who will answer this? Where? What is the image of 3? Under this is consider a sequence also happens to be a function. Sequence is a very special kind of function that we say that it map. It is a mapping from set of natural number to R. So sequence, if someone is writing sequence, so it is always a mapping from N to R. If you try to do, so sequence always happens to be a function. That's why I have taken this definition. So if you are taking n equal to 3, so if you substitute n is definitely, it is an odd number, so you would like to substitute in the second part of this sequence definition. So it would be 3 minus 1, 2, at 2 by 2 is 1, and minus we have already taken, so 3 will map to minus 1. Similarly, if you go 4 will map to 4 divided by 2. 4 is it is an even number, so we can divide it by 2, so 4 will map to 2. And so if you go further, 5, if you take 5, 5 will map to where? 5 will map to negative 2. If you take 6, where 6 will map? 6 will map to 3. 6 divided by 2, it will map to 3. If you take 7, where 7 will map? 7 minus 1 is 6. 6 divided by 2 is 3, and minus sign is coming here. So 7 will map to negative 3. Likewise, so every natural number can be mapped to one integer and vice versa. So that's way we can say that there is a bijection between set of natural number and set of integer. That means we are able to put a point of this natural number in the form of a sequence. So, or you can say that it is like this way. It is in the form of sequence, so we can say that set of natural number is a what? It is a countable set. Now, can you say that how rational number is a countable set? Anyone? Can you say that? Can we say that whether it is a countable set or not? Don't. Much no, it is countable. Just look into definition of rational number. What is the definition of rational number? Just look into one thing that you will never commit mistake if you go to basic of every question. So just what I ask a question that whether rational number is integer, sorry, countable or not. So just you see that rational number is made from integers, and integer we have already seen that it is a countable set because there is a bijection from integer to n or n to vice versa, when n to integer. yeah, ratio of two integers. So definitely due to that it would be countable. But question is that how we can prove that ratio of two integer is a countable? That is a question. Here what is happened? A rational number always we write p by q, where p and q both happens to be integer. We are saying that both belongs to Z, and we put one more condition, q should not be zero, otherwise it will be not defined, ratio will not define. So this is the definition of rational number, we know that. Now question is coming that how we can say that this ratio of integer is again, if you take collection of all the ratio of integer, that means rational number, why it would be countable? So it is directly, so this is the ratio we have taken two integer together. So this together we can talk about this p by q in the simple form order pair. Also we can talk about in order pair p comma q in this order pair. So this order pair is what? It is talking about z cross z. That means it is talking about Cartesian product of z cross z. And there is a very interesting concept given by I think Contour has given or Euler has given to prove this is a countable set. Z cross Z is a countable set. If you face problem in order to prove Z cross Z is countable, so what you do? Before we know that there is a bijection between Z to N and Z to N. So don't go to prove Z cross Z directly, countability of Z cross Z. Prove the countability of N cross N first. Then you can go to prove countability of Z cross Z. So what you do? N cross N. How you can prove countability? So what is meaning of n? N cross n. So you can write element of n cross n in a very sequential pattern like this way. So take one in the first place and take remaining, including one other element in the second coordinate, and keep on going further. So you are trying to list all the member of n cross n. So you are writing like a 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, and it will go like this way. You have first here you can observe that first entry is 1 and second entry it is keep on varying. It is varying from 1 to it will go up to infinity. So 1, 4. I am trying to list all the entries of n cross n. So it is very difficult to list all. So that's why we are having a concept of sequential representation. So 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, and it will go on. It will go. Now second row it will start with like this way. 2, 1, 2, 2. That means first entry is fixed, it is 2, and second entry is, it is keep on varying. So 2, 2, third entry in the second row would be 2, 3, and it will keep on varying, it will go up to infinity. 2, 4, it will go on like this way. So now, so like this is the second row, likewise you can, so you are getting a number system, a array having infinite number of rows and infinite number of columns. So that pattern we observe. So there also we can observe countability. That means we can observe a sequential pattern. So how we can observe that? So I will give that as well. So right now I am not going in detail. That theoretical proof is very much complicated. I am just trying to give a picture, pictorial form of this one. A very simple representation of countability of n cross n. It will go on 3. So what you do? Try to find something common in this representation of number. So it will go up to infinity. It will go up to infinity. It will go up to infinity. So it is infinity cross infinity kind of array. Okay. So what you do? Try to see diagonally. What you do? What is the sum of this one? Sum of this one is 2. 1 plus 1 is 2. Then you don't observe sum 2 anywhere apart from this one. So it is your first entry. Then try to observe that what is the sum of the entries in this order pair. sum of this one is 2 plus 1 is 3 and sum of this one is 1 plus 2 is also 3. So you map like this way. So least sum is 2, then next sum would be 3, and it will go like this way. Then we will come to next sum will be 1 plus 3 is 4, 2 plus 2 is 4, and 3 plus 1 is also 4. So all these will be in together, and it is making like this way. So it will keep on going like that, this way. Here it will, here 4 comma 1 and 4 comma 2, it will go like that way. So you define, you have already defined a map where there is a diagonal kind of relation is coming. So this pair has been mapped to these two pair has been mapped to 3, these three has been mapped to these three pair has been mapped to 4. So likewise, this one has, these four pairs has been mapped to where 5 and 6, like this way. So in this process you will get a countable or bijection map from n cross n to n, or simply it is not necessary that you can exclude one here. I'm writing it n minus 1. One we have already excluded. So there is a bijection between n cross n to n minus 1. So that's way this set n cross n is a countable set, and due to that z cross z is countable set. Due to that you can say that the rational number is also countable set. But remember, real number is not countable. Why? Due to presence of irrational number, real number is not countable. So other thing, conditional probability I will discuss in next class. It is already we have already exceeded time. So further, if you have any question regarding countability, then I will send a write up over this one, so that you may go through in detail a study of that. And if you face any problem, just let me know. Okay, regarding attendance, I also okay, put your attendance there in the comment box. And further, if you have any question, let me